Okay, so the purpose of this video is to compare the requirements of GS38 with some physical examples, what we've got in front of us.
We're going to have a more detailed look at GS38, and we're going to look specifically at the equipment itself, test probes and clips, and the leads. We're going to talk a little bit about ensuring the equipment is working before doing any testing, but also after doing any testing to ensure it's still working correctly. And I'm going to start off by going to the back of the document where it talks about examination of equipment. And before we use any equipment, whether it be access equipment, etc., I'm going to make sure that the equipment itself isn't damaged, there's no parts missing, no cracked cases, the leads themselves aren't damaged, etc. And that's correcting any equipment use, isn't it, Dave? Just to make sure, you know.
Basic check. Straight at your toolbox, at your tool bag, just do a quick check, run it through your hands, cracks, splits, all intact, there's nothing missing, there's nothing exposed, fantastic.
Yeah, and it talks about, you know, examination of equipment at the end of GS38, as I've said, but I think we should focus on that to start with. So, within GS38 then, it looks specifically on page 4 at test equipment itself. And what we're going to do is relate what the requirements are into actual reality and looking at some of the common test equipment that most electricians will have in their toolkit. So under test equipment then, it talks about test probes, clips and leads. And the test probes, clips and leads, used in conjunction with any electrical test equipment, should be selected, of course, to prevent danger. Modern test probes and clips and leads should... First of all, it talks about conform to the requirements of BSEN 61010-031, or in the case of a two-pole voltage detector, BSEN 61243-3. So any test equipment we use must comply with the relevant product standard. So where would we find that information, Dave?
So again, picking your equipment up, this should be clearly visible on the equipment itself. We can see on the back of this device, we've got a BS number on there, which matches the one that Rich has just spoken about. We've got another two-pole indicator in front of us, the same thing. It's got a category rating, it's got a BS number on there. If it's not got anything printed on there, we shouldn't be using it.
It says that they should also be marked with the rated installation category, either category 2, category 3, or category 4. It gives us some additional information at the bottom of page 4 there, and it gives us information relating to the different category numbers. So category 4, your equipment then is suitable for measurements performed at the source of the low voltage installation. So the primary overcurrent device, the metering, etc. So what types of tests would we need category 4 rated equipment for, Dave?
So things like your external air fault loop impedance, ZE.
Yep.
Polarity live.
Yep.
Of your incoming supply.
Phase sequence or something.
Phase sequence.
Okay.
PFC.
Yep.
PSCC.
Yep.
So category 4 is what we'd need for that.
Okay. Category 3 then, we can use category 3 equipment for measurements performed within the building installation, so maybe at distribution boards, socket outlets, you know, permanent connected equipment, category 3 rated. Or category 2 equipment then is for measurements performed on the circuits that are directly connected to that low voltage installation. You might be testing at pieces of equipment, portable tools, etc. So we're kind of looking at a minimum of category 3, would you say?
Yeah, but what you might find is that a lot of the equipment that we use in industry, particularly our two-pole voltage indicators, are category 4. And where we'd find that information is where we found the information with the BS number. So it should be clearly printed on the equipment that you're using. The same on this particular device, more or less in the same place as the BS number. And even on our test leads and probes, off our sort of multifunction testers, it's engraved on this one, so it can't even be rubbed off, and it'll tell us what category rating is. This one's category 4, so I could use this for everything. So personally, if it's category 4, I know I can use it for everything in the installation. If it was category 3 or 2, I can't use it for everything, so really I'll be leaning towards category 4.
And does that also apply to the crocodile clips themselves as well? Because,
yeah,
you know, it might be clipping on or attaching to maybe the main earthing conductor, etc.
Yeah, well, obviously, if we're doing something like a ZE test,
yeah,
we would have to use something like this for the main earth. and it is imprinted on the bottom of this crocodile lead as well. So it's okay. Got category rating, category 4.
So we've got BSEN number, we've got rated installation category, either 2, 3, or 4, and we've said that 4 really is what we should be looking for. It talks then a little bit about that they should have finger barriers or are shaped to guard against inadvertent hand contact with live conductors under test. So finger barriers, how would I identify those?
So these obviously aren't just for show. They're to stop you from physically slipping onto something that could be potentially live. So we always want to be using these with your fingers behind. The same with this particular type. And it's obviously when we're testing, we're putting pressure onto terminals and we don't want to be slipping and touching something which could be live. So yeah, a real safety feature of you know, these devices and what we're looking at.
And would we have the same on our probe for our multifunction testers?
Yeah, we can see we've got a finger guard there.
It's like not a little shoulder, isn't it?
Yeah, a little shoulder. Not as prominent as the other ones, but it's doing, it's the same thing. It's stopping me from slipping when I'm putting that probe onto a terminal.
Okay. Talks then about the probes themselves are insulated to leave an exposed metal tip not exceeding 4 millimetres measured across any surface of the tip. Where practicable, it's strongly recommended that it's reduced to 2 mil or less, or you've got spring-loaded retractable type. So what have we got here, Dave?
So we've got this tester. This is what we call a Drummond. This has got 4 mil exposed, no more. Obviously, Richard said, ideally 2. Less is more in this case, especially when we're testing things that could be live. On this particular tester, you won't be able to see a tip because it's hidden with this sprung-loaded retractable tip. So this is a real good safety feature of this device. You won't see the tip until it's pushed down. It can be locked in position as well, but you'll see that it's only 4 mil there, and you know, no more. We don't want to be having too much metal exposed when we're testing.
So if I had any more than 4 mil, they just wouldn't comply. We shouldn't be using them.
I've
seen certainly with some of the probes that you do get with your multifunction testers where, you know, the cover has been lost.
Yeah.
So we've got more than 4 mil now. Yeah. Wouldn't be using that, would we? No. Wouldn't comply.
No. Might be useful if we're belling cables out, but not for, you know, what we're talking about here.
Okay. Talks then about if we're using a multimeter, they should have suitably high breaking capacity, sometimes known as HRC fuses or a fuse with a suitable current rating. So sometimes if the fusing is not built into the instrument, it may be built into the leads.
Yep.
Certainly maybe with multimeters, but some multifunction testers where the fuse isn't built into the instrument itself, we may find that there's a fuse built into the probe or the lead.
Yeah, so it's not uncommon to have the fuse built into the test lead and the test probe. This particular one that we've got in front of us does have a HRC, high rupturing capacity rather, fuse in there. So it's another safety feature. So if anything did go wrong, the fuse will operate before there's any potential damage to the equipment. Same way that your multifunction testers have an inbuilt fuse as well.
So we've looked at the BSEN number, we've looked at the rated installation category, we've looked at finger barriers, we've looked at a maximum exposed metal tip, and we've looked at the need for a fuse lead. Gives us information now then, just relating to the leads themselves. It talks about that they should be adequately insulated, and the choice of that insulating material around those leads, of course, is influenced by the environment in which the leads are to be used. But this test equipment, generally, if it's ours, we'll always try and look after it. But you could tread on it, could put it in the van, you know, could be sat in your toolbox and
trap it in the lid of your toolbox. Yeah. So hence why we spoke about checking it for damage before we use anything.
Yep. So it's, you know, very durable, isn't it? It's like a very thick, reinforced type of insulation.
Yeah, I mean, this is probably, you know, the conductor inside this is probably 4 times as thin, you know, just as hazard a guess. This is super thick, it's super durable, same with the other equipment in front of us.
So if some of that insulation was kind of damaged or missing and maybe they've wrapped a bit of tape around it, it wouldn't be adequate, would it?
We can't. Any damage, we need to get a new one. Okay.
Talks about the leads They may be coloured so that one lead can be easily distinguished from the other, but of course voltage detectors tend not to have different coloured leads. So you might find different coloured ends or so with multifunction tester leads, but our voltage indicators, they're not generally coloured, are they? But the probes might be.
Probes might be. We've got our different coloured leads, haven't we? With our multifunction testers, brown, blue, green, red and black, you know, with our voltage indicators, not typically.
No. Again, the leads should be flexible and have sufficient capacity, and of course, sheathed to protect against mechanical damage. Spoke about that.
Yeah.
And they should be long enough for the purpose, of course, but not too long, so you could trip over them or wrap around yourself,
so
etc. Yeah.
There's a decent length on the testers. Some distribution boards might be working in. The neutral bar and the earth bar might be quite far apart, so these are more than adequate, but they're not too long. I'm going to trip over them as I'm carrying them through.
And the leads that may come with our multifunction tester, again, they're not 5 metres long, are they?
No, they're suitable length.
Yeah.
And again, insulated.
And then finally, the leads themselves, again, don't have any accessible exposed conductors other than the probe tips themselves, or have any live conductors that may be accessible to a person's finger. If a lead becomes detached from a probe or equipment when in use, the test lead or leads are held captive and sealed into the body of the voltage detector.
So in these devices, we can see these can't be detached. I can't pull these out. I can't get access to anything. The only thing that could be potentially alive when I'm testing is the tip on the end, which is, you know, very, very small, 4mm, ideally two.
And with our leads from our multifunction tester, there is no live parts that we can touch?
Correct. So we may have a probe on the end. Even if this was plugged into the meter, the probe was removed, there's nothing that I can access there that could be potentially live.
Because they're all kind of held captive, yeah?
So
if I had, a lead from a multifunction tester where the lead wasn't made by that manufacturer of the tester, you've bought another lead made by somebody else, and it didn't have that plastic shroud or something, I shouldn't be using that, should I?
No. You should be using the test leads and probes, the same manufacturer and the same standard to the test equipment that you're using.
It gives us then two images, one of a set of voltage indicators that would comply and a set that wouldn't. So we've looked at some of the requirements of GS38, but have we got a set of voltage indicators here, Dave, that probably wouldn't be suitable, and the reasons why?
So these are obviously a very old set of voltage indicators. Straight away we can see the non-compliant to what the GS38 states. We've got more than 4mm of exposed tip on there. The finger barrier, the finger guard is broken. The insulation is got a bit bumpy. There's a little split in it. So I would never consider using these. The category rating is in a category 3. So this won't be able to test everything, but I wouldn't consider using these for doing anything other than perhaps belling a cable out. So there's certain things that we can use, which we've shown you. There's certain things which we can't use and we shouldn't be using, and that's things like this. Other things that we shouldn't be using are things like multimeters. If you think about things like safe isolation, we're trying to measure for voltage, we may select the current rating on this. We may even have the probe in the wrong place. So there's certain items of equipment that are fantastic and that we should use for certain things, and then there's some which we shouldn't. So if we're looking at safe isolation, no multimeters, please, and no damaged and unsuitable equipment.
Okay. It gives us a bit of information on the two different categories of voltage detectors that we might come across. One is an illuminated indication, a test lamp or similar. We've got an old set of drum and test leads here. And the other more modern type is where we may have two or more independent indicating systems, one of which could be audible. So again, another set of modern voltage indicators here, where we may have a visual indication and also an audible indication. So two different sets there. And the old-fashioned drum and test leads, still widely used in industry. There's an image of them within GS38, and there's also an image of the more modern voltage indicators here. He then talks about that if we're conducting a test to simply establish the presence or absence of voltage, a proprietary test lamp or a two-pole voltage detector, both of which here, suitable for the working voltage, should always be used rather than the multimeter, as Dave's explained. It then reminds us that any device that we're going to use to prove dead, it may fail to indicate danger, i.e. it may become faulty as we're conducting the test. It may become faulty since the last time we used it, etc. So any device we're going to use should be proved before and after use. This should be done preferably on a voltage proving unit. Some devices have a built-in proving unit, or otherwise a known live source of a similar voltage to the circuit under test, providing precautions are taken to prevent danger arising. So what they're ideally looking for is verifying our equipment is working before and after on a proving unit. And there's many manufacturers that make them widely available.
Yep.
And we've got a couple of examples here.
Yeah, we've got the two examples which I was showing you as Rich was talking through there. It doesn't actually matter which manufacturer we use. We'll see that we can use this one not only on the matching manufacturer, we can also use it on this one. But it's vital that we check the equipment's working before and after, whichever we choose to use.
Finally, it talks about single pole or non-contact live circuit detectors, sometimes referred to as volt sticks. Most electricians will have a volt stick, and again, there's many manufacturers that that make them. And it reminds us that we should only really use these for identifying live equipment, and we can't rely upon them for proving that something is dead. But they are a useful tool. There are particular requirements for use of these non-contact devices if you're working in coal mines. And specifically, it says only devices which make contact with the conductor, not a proximity device like these, should be used for proving dead. It does remind us, though, that these non-contact or proximity devices can be useful if you want to find out if something is potentially live. A good example is if, you know, you're going inside a trunking that contains many single insulated conductors, and you can see if something's live within that trunking, etc. So a very good tool, but we cannot rely upon them.
Yeah, I think what we're trying to say is these have their uses, but they shouldn't ever be used. They shouldn't be ever be relied on for safe isolation.
Yeah.
Some people may use them. We shouldn't be using them. Yeah, we should be using the equipment in front of us, which confirms with the requirements of GS38.
And those are the main requirements in terms of the probes, clips and leads of GS38. And we've tried to translate that out of the guidance document into some everyday equipment. And hopefully that's been of some use to you.
And just to say as well, the document we've been referring to today is free to download from the HSE website. The HSE produced this document. It's referred to in the electricity work regulations, of which is law. So I think it's a good idea if we comply with that standard, wouldn't you say?
Absolutely, Rich? And it's also referred to in the IT's guidance note 3, and it's also referred to within our own best practice guide 2, safe isolation, because it is a fundamental requirement. We shouldn't be carrying out any work on live equipment or circuits, etc., unless our equipment fully complies with all the requirements set out within GS38.
So what you'll find is this document relates to our best practice guide 2, which is free to download on our website, Electrical Safety First. You'll find on page 17, we have referenced the GS38 requirements, and you'll be able to scan a QR code, which you may have already done. It's taking you through to this video.
Well, we hope that's been some use. Look out for our future videos coming up very soon. See you again soon.
See ya.